Hey, Eddie, you remember our wedding, so you realize that she's the event Nazi. Thanks for coming, Mr. Mayor.
Event coordinator.
Good to see you, buddy. So cocktail party my pad after this.
Okay.
All right.
So
how long do you think we're going to go here?
About 3 hours. Oh, dude, what are you very relaxed, she said.
Well, that's good. You should be.
Oh, well, yeah.
It's your birthday.
And a teenage werewolf, relaxes me. So, dude, I picked up
I took you up on your thing. I took you up on your thing. No gifts.
Good.
Good to see you.
How are you?
Good. Hey,
don't
birthday
boy. Don't you guys work for them?
No.
Welcome back to the Parkway.
How did you manage to get down here on Wednesday?
This guy's from a writer.
I know.
This is work for him.
Yeah, exactly. From
I got pictures.
I have a charger coming down this week, though.
My battery's died.
Maybe you can use my thing to charge it.
Whose battery's died?
Why?
That's what we're here to celebrate, the death of my battery.
So are we upstairs?
Yes, dude. It's all ours. I don't care.
Excuse me. Already angry with you.
The guy
every time I go on the book, he writes reviews on it. Like,
you guys ready? Got your material ready?
He's having a drink. See where Kyle is?
I got him. You know why? It's probably for that thing next month.
Well, no. I wanted you to make sure.
No. Yep, Elvis is in the building.
That's
another. Yeah, at least it's not rock. It's jazz. Hi. Look at this nice spread. Look who's up there.
Go down there and see.
I know, there he is.
You might go down there and see.
I should. This song is from 1927. Make believe with you.
Thanks, Pally.
Well, it is a living room, so somebody better live there.
Yeah. I do believe I took him to my Girl Scout trip to talk about being a writer. Did
didn't I take you to my Girl
Scouts?
Why did
you take Will?
Why did I take Will?
Save the material. Save the material, okay? There's a joke there somewhere.
Why would
he wouldn't say anything to those sweet little.
There's a joke there somewhere. Save it.
He wouldn't say.
Hey, Dave.
What?
Oh, okay. That, there you go, for posterity. What? All right.
Well,
here we go.
Hey, look. It's already started.
Can I film for a while for you? So you can be in your birthday.
I'll find the wine man.
Julie, you can join me in this chair.
I'll be there in a bit. Well, no, your wife should do that.
Well, she's not here.
Go for it, Dino.
Everybody wants to worry sometimes. Everybody falls in love sometimes. Something in my heart keeps saying, why sometimes? What you doing over there, Will? How you doing?
Hey, Dino.
Get it on the good looking bras, not me. Where am I at?
Wow.
Oh, I'm standing right here. In my heart.
Whoa, there's a cutie.
My sometimes is here. If I had it in my power, I'd arrange for every girl to have your child.
Happy to see you, Dino.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah. I'm there, Apple. I'm done. I'm going home. I got my booze. I sang my song. Push the button. Well, wait.
I just started recording. Perfect timing.
Okay, to make it easier on Will, Will and Monica have decided to have a test tube baby, but the test tube had a headache.
Oh!
You know, Will was, I don't want to say Will was unloved for most of his life, but he was an only child and he still wasn't the favorite. On his birthday, everyone in the whole family would go to the zoo and throw rocks at the stork. Getting back to Will's starvation for attention, I went over their house the other day and he had towels in the bathroom that were marked his and his.
That's another story.
Well, I would have got a lot farther, but I only got here 10 minutes ago, so you guys are a great audience. Minute.
Thank you, Alan.
Oh, hey. And you, buddy, be careful or I'll light a match near you.
Okay. It's my turn again.
Yes, sir.
For the first time. Wait a second here. We're gonna. Oh, I know who we're gonna bring up now. I'm gonna do this a cappella. Maureen Thomas.
Tomas, there you go.
Now it says here, because I don't...
You got to read them both. Do Maureen and then do the Dave's thing.
Okay. Aside from being the better half of the comedy duo Tomas and Tomas, she is also a successful producer. There's no period there.
There's no period producer.
Her most acclaimed productions are Laura, Adrian, Hillary, and Sarah.
Monica didn't have a period this month.
And also Dave Tomas, as Will's godfather and spiritual guide, he is the most important man here because he delivered Will to the trinity of Frank, Dino, and Sammy.
Yay!
And when he took Will to one of the final Rat Pack concerts in Oakland, California. Oh, and yeah, that's what he, yeah. Please welcome the only man, what's this writing here?
With the dubious.
Please welcome the only man in the room with the dubious, yeah.
Distinction
of being able to, you gotta write the words in English, of being able to give Will.
You gotta stop drinking before you read them.
His hand-me-down clothes. Maureen and Dave.
Come on, Dave.
Can you do it that way?
Why not?
If you guys had something
you get to use that one. This one has reverb. That one doesn't.
Thank you, sir. Well, I've never done a roast before, but thank you.
Get right up to it. There you go.
Show me how, Dave. What's the head action again? Okay.
He said kiss it.
Pull it closer.
Get it on there. We're not supposed to be.
Is this better?
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's it, baby.
But what I wanted to do tonight was share some of the closer moments going back about 20 years ago or so. To Berkeley, California. I know these memories are close to Will, maybe a little sensitive to Will. And I'm gonna start it off with his days as a waiter at the Faculty Club in Berkeley. And if he doesn't remember, I'm gonna ask you to put that on top of your head. No, I'm gonna ask you to put it on top of your head.
Put it on top of your head!
Do it! Do it!
How this young man
does
started
he get
out when
keep
he
the
left,
fez?
When
oh
he
no,
left Southern
towel.
California.
Yes.
And hot he came towel. To work as a waiter. Not a lot of experience, as they say, but he had a great attitude. And And thankfully, we've got some chafing dishes here because, as Will remembers, working banquets wasn't the easiest task in his life, aside from putting salads together for the dining room.
Because it was work.
Hey, it wasn't his life. He was a writer.
Or was he?
He told me he was a writer. I believe the man. You know, I tried to give him every bit.
He's gonna publish anything in his life.
Hey,
a writer,
just relax. Just relax out there.
You know, bicycle.
Give him.
He's saying he's whiter. He's a little whiter than you, Kyle.
Thank you.
Ignore them.
Thank
they're
you,
all
thank
drunk.
You. Thank you. But Will, I was just wondering. You know, when you saw this buffet as you walked in, I know those goosebumps creeped up on you on the back of your neck. And I saw that sterno flame burning over there. And I know the first time you ever had to put one of these tables together in the Bowker O'Neill room, it was one of the scarier moments for you. As he came in and we were getting the food ready and he said, Dave, what do I do? And of course, he was very concerned because the gratuity was at least 12% back then. And this is one of his bigger moments of getting out of that dining room from the members who, of course, spoke to him with a lot of encouragement, and tips were never as encouraging as the conversations that he got He goes, Dave, I need to move on to banquets. And when he got his chance, his one of his first questions were, how do I set up one of those chafing dishes? And he said, is there any safety issues involved? And I said, well, since you asked, well, you know, that sterno is flammable. You gotta be a little bit careful. Take this towel, which was soaked in water, put it on your head before you light it, and turn away as you put it.
It worked.
And he came out unscathed. And he walked back into the kitchen with that towel over his head, saying, I think I got it, Chief. And the sincerity in his face showed me that he had at least another 6 months of commitment to his job that, hey, I'm not a server, I'm a writer. And he made it. And there were a lot of other moments out there when he had to put his salads together for the entire dining room. And we all know Will has an intensity about him, and it may not be food related, it may not be service related, it may not be people related. Because this man is in another world, but I'll tell you something. When I pulled him aside and I said, look at these salads that were covered with brown edges and frayed leaves. I said, well, would you eat this salad? And he looked at me wholeheartedly with those big eyes and about 70 pounds lighter than he is today. And said, of course I would. And you ask me why I have this flat forehead right now. And I understood. And as sincere as he was, the man still didn't get it. He said, it's just a job. I'm not a food server, I'm a writer. And here comes this W word again. I'm a writer. And so I knew I needed help. And so I looked to other managers at the time because I knew I had my hands full. Aside from Tanaki. And that's no four-letter word to this group, I know that.
That's his old girlfriend.
It's everybody's girlfriend, honey.
But there were times and there were letters later. And I know Will understands all this, and I don't want to get into all the verbatim and all the discussion, because I think you handled it extremely well. I was talking to the two Richards the other day. And there was somebody named Michael that emailed me and said, I wish I could be there. I mean, you got a lot of friends from your past that aren't here.
That's why I made it.
And
okay, Dave, we're running out of tape here.
Yeah, and so am I. I thought I had my cues down, but evidently I'm getting left out. I'm getting left out. Anyway, what I wanted to say, regardless of all that growing up you did.
Before I'm 50, Dave.
All that growing up, and. And I don't remember if you remember that conversation at McNally's, but, because I certainly don't. Oh, thank you. Or that time down at Lakeshore for your birthday when we're looking for Prince and Sheila E. shows up and he's hiding behind the corners looking for, oh my God.
Can I get some arsenic in this, please?
But regardless, we all still love you. And if you believe that,
speak for yourself.
your next 40 years are going to be even more special.
Yay!
I'll take the next one if you want.
Oh, you're going to?
No, if you want, you can do it.
I
want
to do it.
I'll be your lovely assistant. I'll just point out words to you. No, no. There's a couple I have.
Okay.
All right, next on the list.
Who is it?
Mr. Dave Ortiz.
That's it. Dave Ortiz is the second most important man here. Second, I thought I was.
Third.
Okay. I'm going home then. You get your butt up here. Dave Ortiz is the second most important man here, as he was the person who introduced Will to Hawaiian shirts. So now we know who to blame. Thank you. Where are those drum rolls when you need them? Dave has known Will so long that he used to be able to give Will his hand-me-downs. Hand-me-downs. Please welcome Dave Ortiz.
Yay! Woo! Dave-o!
There you are.
Hey. Thanks. So you're gonna have to speak
up.
You're gonna have to speak up now that the band's on.
Yeah, I know. I'm not a very good public speaker here, but.
Grasp it like you mean it, put your mouth. Yeah, you gotta get close.
I gotta tell you, you don't have to kiss it. It's worse than that.
Just don't.
Okay, turn it up. There you go.
I've known Will. I take a deep breath when I say that.
There you go.
There you go.
There we go. Thank you. I've known Will for, I don't know, as long as he's been here in California. That's too loud.
Well, you're
not kissing it. No, it's not. No, it's not. You gotta keep your mouth close to it, honey.
I don't really have a prepared statement to say, although all my Hawaiian shirts have been donated to the troops in Iraq.
Which side?
I did have some notes, though. Will came to the Planet Faculty Club about 20 years ago, and he did come to us and got a job as a waiter, and he said, you know, we pull him aside and said, what's wrong with you, man? It's like, he said, I'm not a waiter, I'm a writer. Like,
the theme.
You're not a waiter. Well, we've all been through this thing. I mean, it's an individual thing. And, yeah, he's definitely not a waiter. And then, you know, he was kind of, I can't say this too harshly because at the time he was scrawnier, and he was my size, smaller than me, now he's all, you know, big pecs and stuff now. And, we used to sit around at the bar at the faculty club and have a beer. We would all be drinking, like, many beers, but Will could only handle, like, one beer. And then he'd go home to his cats, or his cat, and then his IBM Selectric typewriter. And, well, we knew he was a writer because he wasn't a drinker either, you know. Then one day he asked me, he says, you know, I got this new job. I need to learn how to drive a stick shift. I need to learn how to drive. A car. He's been on public transportation since he left New Jersey. So one day, I said, it was like a couple of drinks into this. He's like, yeah, can you teach me how to drive a stick shift? Do you remember this? Oh, yeah.
I don't know who you are.
So I say, yeah, I can do that. You know, I have a couple of drinks and say, sure, I can teach you how to drive a stick shift. No problem. I got a car. It's insured. Meet me at the Trader Vic's parking lot on Tuesday morning, really early. And Will showed up there. I think that's the first time he saw Trader Vic's. It was early in the morning, and I got to teach him how to drive this car because he didn't know how to drive anything. Well, because he didn't have any girls. also, driving a car was kind of new to him, other than that thing with Mickey Rourke. I never understood that. So we're in the middle of the parking lot, in early morning, foggy, this is 15 years ago. No, it's only, I can tell you exactly when it was. My son is 11, so this was 10 years ago. Oh, we have another special guest here.
Couple more.
My son's 11 years old now, so at that time, this is 10 years ago, and I teach Will how to drive a stick shift with my son, an infant, in the back seat of the car.
Oh, bad idea.
This is why I remember this so well. He never got out of first gear. We drove circles and circles and circles around the parking lot. And the guys over there at Trader Vic's, you know, the bus boys, the Chinese bus boys are over there just hacking out loud through their cigarettes. Look at this guy. And I'm glad. So my brother learned to drive in a parking lot too, and he rammed right into one of those posts. You didn't do that. But you never got out of second gear either. I would love to be a driver. Anyway, my son's still alive. Every time Will comes over, he runs. And I'll tell you this. It's good to know that Monica is wearing the driving gloves in your family. Also, let's go to the notes.
Wait, I have the wine on the
page. Okay, wait, while he's going to the notes, I'm switching off.
The music tonight is being prepared by Infinity Sounds, Infinity Broadcasting. There's no variations to the sound play. When you turn 50, I'll be there with you, man.
I think I just did.
Yay!
Oh, that was good. Here's a nice one. This is a glamorous person, movie star in an Elvis movie and several TV shows to her credit. And also to her credit is the fact that she is one of the few women in Hollywood who has ever been married to Will's father, Julie Parrish.
Never been married.
That's why I said has never been married.
Black coffee over here.
Read the next one.
Okay. That's what I said.
That's not true.
Okay. I'm just reading what
I'm taking, you know.
I didn't straighten it out, Julie.
I was never married to Will's father. Ever. I've never even had sex with Will's father.
See, the writer always gets screwed here. It says, to her credit, she's one of the few women in Hollywood who's never been married to Will's father. So it's to your credit that you have good taste. Thank you.
I just read the words.
Actually, you know that little awful film that he made with all that noise in the background that Annie and your ex stepmother was a part of? She introduced me to your father at that time, and well, anyway, he made a pass at me. I couldn't believe it. Well, he's married to somebody who looks like his daughter, dresses her like his daughter.
What a mess. Sounds familiar.
What a mess he is. I talked to him today. I called him to see if he was coming down. And he said that he didn't like this kind of thing. And so I said, okay. I was looking for a ride, actually. I didn't want to spend the $50 in gas it took to get here, but I felt so sorry for Will.
He is pathetic.
That none of his family was coming. I said,
his uncle Bill's here, though.
I'm always for the downtrodden. So I called Annie, and Annie really would have liked to have been here, but Annie had just, his ex-stepmother, is one of my best friends, had actually looked forward to some of the gang being here from the family, because I have a good time with them, and I got here and I knew nobody. Well, briefly, some people I met, and Monica.
You're marrying my father already.
No, please. Please.
You know Dino.
Okay. Well, I didn't really plan a speech, but since I'm the biggest name here,
that is Will.
Really Don't sad. Will. That is fucking sad. I mean, I did Winter a Go-Go. I did Elvis, one of Elvis's worst movies. Paradise Hawaiian style. I had a bit part in a couple of other movies, and then there was the Doberman Gang, which did well on TV. I was the girl in that. The review on that movie said that I must have been having a hard time financially. I swear to God. And anyway, that's how bad it was. Will, I met you when you invited me to come up and be the guest person for Elvis's, it was his birthday or his death day, I forget which. But Annie had been there the year before, and she told me about it, and you invited me up, and I really just fell in love with you. You were the saddest little thing I'd ever met. You were driving a blood truck or something like that. And then shortly after that, you got married to somebody you'd known for a minute. And you found out she was bipolar.
Bisexual.
That's wife number two.
And she'd left you, or you'd left her. I think she left you. That was it. Because you really wanted a family. And it just blew up right in your little face. But then most of us, your family and I, had given you talks before, like really for hours, saying, don't do this. This is insane to marry somebody you've known for a minute. You found out, didn't you?
A minute later.
Yes. It lasted what? Less than 30 days? Okay. Anyway, I really love you, Will. And I was honored to be there for you when you were going through that bullshit. And able to help you through that, because I was a counselor at a shelter for battered women for about 10 years. And so I could help you a bit. Anyway, that's all I have to say, except that I love you a lot, and I'm happy to be here, and I think that you and Monica are a great team. You have minds that work alike, and I'm really happy for you, and when I would give anything to be 40 again. When I was 40, I had a boyfriend who was 20 years younger than me. Great time. Unfortunately, he wanted to have children. And his parents were Jewish, and they were really upset that they weren't going to have grandchildren. They liked me, though. They're still my friends. All right. Happy to be here. Happy birthday.
Okay, I have to do the next one.
You're going to do the next one. Okay. I'm going to just sit here.
Trying to beam?
I don't carry anything.
Hold on. Okay. One second.
So we're all here tonight to roast Will Viharo. You're the guy right there, right?
Yeah.
I remember from the, you had a party in Emeryville one night. So this guy has the ugliest butt I've ever seen in my entire life.
I'm gonna chicken bone up.
I didn't see that.
Cut.
I just had to make a side, little side comment. It's all yours.
No, do it. You have to roast him at some point. You want to do your report now?
I'm done.
Oh.
D-U-N, done.
Short roast for a short man. Thank you. So next up, I'd like to. So Kyle and Catherine, are you going to each talk separately? Separately? Okay. So I'll introduce you both. We have Catherine Fisher, camera woman extraordinaire. Catherine has been Will's friend for so long that she knew him when he only had 3 stepmothers. Kyle and Will work together, as well as being good friends, and sometimes they butt heads. Nothing personal, they're just very different. Will likes the classic movies of TMC, Turner Classic Movies. Kyle likes the new classics of TNN. Will is very passionate, and sometimes he comes across as irrational, high-strung. Kyle is very laid back, so sometimes he comes across as passive and weak, that sort of thing. Will is short, Kyle is tall. Will is white, Kyle is... Oh, wait, no. Well, let's just say they have some things in common. So let's bring up Kyle and Catherine.
You see my glasses? You can talk several
things.
We're slappy white.
Is this the one that
has... What an asshole.
You know, Dean Martin was talking about Will's sorry ass that we saw at his bachelor party. What Dean failed to mention was that he had a chicken bone up his ass during the time. And I have it on videotape if anybody wants to see. Which brings us to why he's so upset with me. He's just tired of being the bottom all the time. But we can talk about some of this shit later. Actually, Julie brought something up earlier about his previous marriage to Rachel, the bipolar. You guys only have a passing memory of this because you didn't have to live through it. You guys got him before, in his days of jubilation, right before he got married. We got him in his days of sorrow after she kicked his sorry, flabby ass out of the house.
After he quit his job.
Quit his job.
His wife, and then called
lost his wife. Had no place to go. No money. With that sorry ass looking for a place to live. You guys missed the salad days. We didn't.
I look like I missed my salad day.
Let me tell you about a couple of the salad days. We had a wonderful house back then. God, it was beautiful. Nice San Francisco, Upper Haight. Catherine, my wife, had spent 2 years working on a beautiful garden on the side. She had spent 2-3 hours out there a day. Will came by, said, "I need a place to live." He said, "Shit, you know, what the fuck can he do?
I need a place to live.
I have no money." So we decide to leave one day and we say, "You know, Will, you know," he said, "what can I do for you guys?" We said, "You know, you could do a little weeding if you need to." And Catherine said, "You know, Will, it's a big backyard. It's almost half the size of this room." And she said, "You know, ignore that small patch over there because that's too hard to explain." We get home that night, and Will says, "God damn, I've been working out here hard today. Oh. I did a lot of weeding."
Oh.
You guys are going to be really happy.
Oh.
But I got to admit, it looks a little barren. What'd you say, Catherine?
I said, "Don't worry, Will. After you weed, it always looks bare because it's all cleaned up. It'll be fine.
I wake up the next morning. I see my wife staring out the window, tears running down her face.
Oh.
the three trees that were in the backyard are the only fucking thing left standing. He had cleaned out everything she had done for 3 years.
Oh.
It was clear.
Oh.
Good job, Will. Good job.
Oh.
Another Rachel experience. Will's, I don't know if you guys know this, but Will's kind of in love with Don Johnson. He's always been in love with Don Johnson. He's almost fashioned his life after Don Johnson. In the 70s, Don Johnson did Miami Vice, or in the 80s, Don Johnson was thin back then. Will was pretty thin back then, too. Then he went on to do Nash Bridges. Don was in wearing a girdle. Still looked pretty good, but had put on about 50 pounds. Buddy, you still look good. You put on about 50 pounds. We're hoping that Don Johnson doesn't become Orson Welles. You're getting there.
So one day we find out that Don Johnson is filming nearby, and we thought, well, we'll take Will there so he can meet his idol and take his book that's been published. And we get there, and we're waiting, and finally Don Johnson drives up. And at that moment, Will is struck down with a migraine and can't see a thing.
The love had just hit him too hard. And he finally met his idol and went blind from a migraine. So that was Will's experience in San Francisco.
It was repressed lust.
No, it's not repressed lust. I've seen Will's repressed lust. And that brings us to another story. That lust was repressed for a good 30, 35, 40 years until he met you, Monica, and we're so happy that he did, because you are the love of his life. But unfortunately, he was on pace to set the masturbation record for a lifetime until he met you. I know you are, buddy. I'm gonna leave you alone. I love you, you know that. You're the biggest loser in the world, but you're one of the best friends I've ever had in my life.
As much ribbing as we give Will, he's also been there for all of us. Will never forgot any one of my birthdays until Monica came along. Then, of course, you know, he could care less. But before then, he was always there for all my birthdays. And...
What is it again?
What?
And a free meal.
Oh, God. Free meals all the time.
Show him a nipple. He's been waiting for it.
He's seen my nipples. He was in love with my sister once and followed her around until he threw beer at her at a frat party and pulled a knife on all the fraternity brothers. So for all that he plays the cool hipster now, he used to go to frat parties. And he would go into the people's rooms and use their phone to call long distance to some woman he'd fallen in love with who was in a movie he made us all watch over and over and over. Again. What was it? Fade to Black?
The Great Linda Carriage.
Yes.
Will's one of those people that can make me just burst into tears because I get so frustrated.
That's beautiful.
Okay, all done. Happy birthday.
There you go.
Not broad to keep it down.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to talk about our man now. We call him Uncle Bill. Bill the Trailer King. Bill is Will's favorite uncle, not because of his love and support, but because of his incredible collection of classic movie trailers. Driving snack ads and B movies. Bill is a longtime contributor. It's on the next page. To Thrillville. He is. Thank God. No, that's right. He has scoured the movie collections of dead circus performers all over the country to bring the best cinematic offers to thrill seekers every week. Uncle Bill.
Uncle Bill!
Thank you all.
What a macho guy you are. Show Will one exercise. That's all he needs. Is
take that. You the mind!
I'll take this out.
Gotta get real close to it.
I left a meeting of the
Palm Springs Leather Order of the Desert.
All right.
Early. Here we are. So I have to apologize because I'm here. I mean, I'm late. Let's go back to the beginning. I will, number one, hate Bob Shaw for the rest of his life for introducing me to this man. And I worked with Bob for almost 20 years. I thought he was a friend. But when I first heard about this roast, I sat down for about an hour and thought, I'm going to make a presentation. I have to roast Will. I have to think of some good things so I can think of some bad things to say about him. And I sat for about an hour, and then I got up and drank an entire bottle of Pepto-Bismol and said, to hell with it, I'm going to wing this one. So let's go back to the beginning. The first night I meet Will and Monica at the Parkway. This is a scary event. I walk into the theater. Here's this guy in a pink lounge jacket, and his wife is up on stage, or his fiance at the time, is on stage, this beautiful lady. She's spinning a wheel, calling out numbers that have absolutely no relationship to the spinning of the wheel. It took me at least 4 visits to the theater to figure that out. But God bless you. I don't know how you come up with those numbers, but it's terrific.
Magic.
But Will said he knew that I had the trailer collection and he wanted to use the film, and he kept saying to me, Bill, I will do anything for you to get you to bring your trailers over here. And I kept putting him off, and I kept putting him off, and putting him off. And I just sort of let it go. I knew he was hitting on me, and I never had anybody hit on me because of my film collection. And I gave him film just to keep him quiet. And, there were so many other things. Like, Will always surprises me. And it was a situation we had with Brain from Planet Eros, and we couldn't run it, and then I just happened to drop a title like Abbott and Costello Go to Mars, and I thought he was going to have an orgasm on the phone. He said, oh my God, you have that? And we replaced the film with Abbott and Costello Go to Mars, which was quite a disastrous little event. But we did have the mutant from This Island Earth there twice. At least he was there twice anyway. The foam creature. Will surprises me constantly. And the one thing I had to do was, well, of course, he was the main reason I moved to Palm Springs. Because I couldn't stand the badgering I kept getting from him year after year. And I've known him for, about 3.5-4 years now. And it was like, I'll do anything for you as long as I get your collection. So I, was almost going to a proposal of marriage, but I knew he was married, so unless he was bi, as I always suspected anyway. Yes. Of course, with the stories I've heard here tonight, with chicken bones and other things like that, and with the drinking we did last night and going around toucans, asking people whether they liked, who was it, Adam West or Michael Keaton better as Batman. it was quite an evening. Everything's always a surprise with Will. And I moved to Southern California simply to get away from him. And I finally had to tell him, Will, listen, it's not going to work for us. I'm not a chubby chaser. So happy birthday, Will. You've had 40 very strange years. I hope you have 140 more, as long as I'm not there. Happy birthday.
You're up, okay? He's gonna introduce you.
Thank you. We got one more man here. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
That's good, because I can't hear myself. Eddie Muller. As a fellow writer and film.
Singer.
It says, as a fellow writer and film.
Connoisseur.
Connoisseur. No word, there is no word there, and there's a big blank space.
Because I didn't know how to spell connoisseur.
You're going to shout it out.
Yeah. Supply that kind
of thing. It's good.
Come on, tape
running. I'm sorry. Will is, yeah, that's what you is. Will is so jealous of Eddie, not for authoring so many successful books or for hosting such a tremendous film noir. See, I know that word. Wow, film noir festival. But for his, you, just sit there.
I'm sitting.
But
here.
For his most important accomplishment, having a time. Having a tiki bar in his backyard. Eddie Muller.
Eddie Muller.
Come on down. Be cruel.
I will attempt to be cruel. Okay, here's the deal. How the hell do I know this guy to start with? Okay, here's the deal. It was when I was doing the first film noir book, I went to Movie Image in beautiful Berkeley, California.
Yeah.
And I was doing my research for this book, and I would go along the racks in the video store, and I kept noticing that all these video boxes had these weird little post-it things attached to them with this little cribbed writing, you know, talking about all these different movies. And I'd say, who is the really weird, like, anal pervert guy that is writing all this stuff on the video boxes, you know? And then I met him, right? And it was this dude right here, Will.
This pervert.
I mean, he had, like, an opinion about every last little friggin' weird B movie in the world. And I said, man, I hope I never end up like this. I mean, that was... Jesus. And shortly after that, we struck up a friendship because for no other reason than he, like, comped me tapes. You know, that was all, that's it. I hate to tell you, Will, that's the basis of our whole friendship. Because, you know, he let me slide on a bunch of tapes and he always waived the late fee. Right?
So I was like,
so there you have it. That's why I'm here tonight. Because the guy waived late fees, okay?
He would have gotten further than that.
Yeah, you know. So then, one day I go into this place, and he tells me that he's getting married, and he wants me to meet his fiance, and that's when I met Rachel, and I said, and that, to be honest with you, that's when I really decided that I really liked Will, because he was truly a noir guy. You know, I said, I can relate to this guy. I mean, he is really taking a huge risk with this woman. I said, man, because that's what noir is all about. You know you're making a mistake, and you make it anyway. God love you, Will. And then we laugh about it later in Palm Springs, California, with your true friends. You know, that's what it's all about, man. But then I gotta say, after that, I want to make fun of Will. I just want to rip him a new one. But I can't. I just can't, because this guy, I mean, he has such a genuine, true heart. He has been so good to me. For no fucking reason, really. I mean, you know.
Your tiki bar.
See, I don't invite him over enough for him to be that nice to me, you know? He reviews every goddamn thing I, you know, he does book signings at the Parkway like 5 months after the book comes out. He still wants to do a book signing. It's fantastic, you know? And I thought, you know, Will had a couple of screws loose. And, you know, I love that. And then, God forbid, you know, he calls me up one day and he says, you know, I gotta tell you something, I met this woman. And I gotta tell you, man, I am seriously in love and I think she's great. And I said, yeah, right, I saw the last of her.
And then I met Monica, and it's like, hey, you know, there's hope for the crazy people in the world, you know? I mean, this is great. So, I mean, I could... Nobody has talked about the bachelor party. What is that?
Chicken bone.
I meant to do... Oh, yeah, the chicken bone. But I got to tell you something. It's way... never mind.
It's too great we're talking about.
I understand there's video. Is that right?
Yes, there is.
Wow. Dude, that's... How can you relax, man? How can you live a normal day knowing that there's video?
Xanax!
I saw things that night that...
I
want to erase the memory from my mind. There's a particular... What did she write on your chest? I can't remember.
Bitch!
Bitch!
Have you seen the video?
No, I came home. He was coming out of the shower. He had bitch written across his chest.
How did that happen? What was that all about? All I can tell you is my most remarkable memory from that night was that somebody threw a full bottle of Jack Daniels from the 9th floor of that hotel, and it didn't break. And we actually went down and picked it up. We picked it up in the parking lot and came back up and drank it. How did that happen? That was just...
God's intervention.
I figured it was like because Will... Yeah, it is. It's an omen. I said, this marriage is blessed. When you can throw a bottle of your booze off the 9th floor of a hotel and it goes into the parking lot and doesn't break. This is an omen. This is a very, very good omen. So... All I can say, Will, you're my pal, you're aces in my book. I should roast the shit out of you tonight, but I won't, because really, you're one of my favorite people, and you deserve all the good things that happened to you. The two of you, you're great. And that's in conclusion, that's what I have to say.
Yay!
That was too nice.
So, Dino, do you have more to roast Will? Or no? If not, I'll take over.
I've got one thing to say about Will Viharo. The man is generous. Came to perform, out of character here. Came to perform at the theater, Parkway. And the man gives me a stack of free food, pizzas. Yeah, which I don't eat, I can't eat. They sat for 3 years on my desk. But the man is very generous, very kind heart.
Especially with Kyle.
Just enough. Okay, yeah.
Hey, watch out. Who's paying for your hotel room?
Don't go there, because I'll start. Will, you're a hell of a... Monica, my lovely assistant, would you like to wrap this whole thing up?
Yes,
so
I will.
Go drink and get plastic.
All right.
I might even sing another song.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, we should.
Yeah, we'll sing these schmucks downstairs and stuff.
Yeah. All right, folks. Let's see. Pull out the notes. So, as you have gathered, I am the second wife.
Is that what he told you?
You know you're sorry when your wife is bipolar and crazy and she leaves you. So I'm the second wife. And at first I was worried that I was just replacing the first wife, but then my fears were soon assuaged because Will has showered me with so much attention. He loves taking pin-up pictures of me, as you know from seeing his website, as most of Soledad Prison knows. Why? Do I have something on my back?
Flesh.
I have nothing on my back.
That's why I want you to try. Yes.
Okay. So he's taken these pictures of me, which is very sweet, because a lot of men like naked pictures of women. Will just wants naked pictures of his wife, which is, you know, a good thing. So there's pictures of me holding a ray gun,
pictures of me looking at his novel, pictures of me laying on the leopard.
The only one.
Yeah, exactly. On the leopard couch, pictures of me next to a picture of Betty Page. So I wasn't a replacement for his wife, because I later found pictures of his old cat, the one that died, and there's pictures of the cat holding a ray gun, pictures of the cat on a leopard couch, pictures of the cat looking at his novel. So I'm a replacement for the cat, apparently.
You see the 12-year-old boy, too?
Yeah.
And you never looked at the tail of this cat, did you? It was always bent.
It's called
Bobby. I know, right. So Will got divorced the first time, because he did, when he decided to be a lounge lizard, he knew he had to have an ex-wife, so he had to get that over with. And his family was very disappointed when he got divorced, because as a Viharo, they expected by this point in his life he should have been on his third or fourth or fifth divorce, really. Speaking of Will's family, they're actually very famous, the Viharos, for many reasons. Some of them having to do with the law. They actually invented family package bankruptcy for Will and his father and his brother and sister. Will's formative years were spent in New Jersey with his very mean stepmother. They lived in an apartment building that had a pool, and every morning she would make Will swim 25 laps back and forth in the pool. And when she was feeling really nice, she'd actually put water in the pool. So when I met Will, he was living a very simple life. He lived in this little one-room apartment, this little saggy pull-out couch. And every day when he went to work, he would take a little plastic grocery bag of like books and things that he was gonna look at work, you know, rather than actually work. And so one day he comes home from working and he's so excited and he says, "Look what I found." And he shows me a cassette case. I'm like, "Yeah." And he's like, "You rip out the inside and it's a briefcase." Well, cassette cases don't have the four posts on the bottom, they only have two. So I hated to break the news to him that no, that's a cassette case. Everyone knows it's a cassette case. And poor Will would walk around Berkeley so proud of his cassette case, come briefcase, and when he put it down on the floor, it would always fall over, you know, because it only had the two spokes on the bottom. So for his birthday that year, I gave him a briefcase. I didn't even know if we were going to stay together, but I just thought, you know, I have to get this sorry-ass guy a bag, because it's just embarrassing. But it's not so bad being the second wife, because I felt like, you know, before we got married, Will should sow his wild oats, but in Will's case, it was more like an oat. I'm glad, though, that it took a while for Will and I to meet, because I think all men should sleep with, you know, at least two women in their lives. When Will and I started living together, I just realized that, you know, he's really into things being in their place and neat and put away. He's the only man I've ever met who couldn't have sex, not because he had a headache, but because there were dirty dishes in the sink.
Oh my God.
Which is true.
What? No,
that's...
Because there's no... He can't have sex if there's dirty dishes in the sink.
Yeah. Wow.
This is like now. Like, he follows me around, picking up my things, putting them away. Yeah, it's annoying. Anyway. So we mentioned Don Johnson. So Will and I, we stayed together after the whole, you know, him being fastidious about every little thing. He has to take a Xanax every time he opens up a CD case and the wrong CD is in it. It's very upsetting. All the numbers and letters have been rubbed off our label maker because he's made so many labels. In fact, I came home one time and he had labeled all our drawers. I don't mean the furniture, I mean my underwear. Like, they were labeled.
Ow! Yeah.
So Will and I finally got married, right? And thank you. Yes. So Will was really excited on our wedding day because he found out, not so much because he was going to spend his life with me, he found out that our bridal suite had FX channel on it, and at like 12:35. Miami Vice would come on. This is a true fucking story. So it's the winding down of our wedding, and I'm looking around and my husband is gone. I go up to the hotel room. I can hear Miami Vice. I can hear the car screeching. And I start knocking on the door. No answer. I knock a little more. No answer. I'm banging on the door in my wedding dress.
No.
And Will will not give up Dawn to let me in.
Oh.
He wasn't finished with him.
The sad part is it's actually Philip Michael Thomas that he's into. That's the sad part.
But what I would most what I most would like to say is I hope you have full glasses because I'm going to make a toast. Oh. Or put something in your glass, spit in your glass, do something. This is kind of long, so we don't toast just yet, but what I want to say is, Will
close.
The Thrill...
Close.
Will the Thrill is the most secure, unselfconscious, and brave person I know because he lets these people he calls his friends roast him. I don't think there's anyone in this room who would be brave enough to do this. Sure as hell, it wouldn't be me. We make fun of him, but everything we make fun of are things that we admire. One, that he's a romantic, that he didn't care about dating, he wanted to be in love and get married. That he, all his chaotic and turbulent childhood and adolescence has made order out of chaos with labels and boxes and displays all over the place. That he is a truly loyal person to his cat, to his friends, many of whom,
to
Dawn. And it's really a testament to Will's loyalty and his ability to be a good friend that there are several people here tonight who've known Will for 20 or more years. Mm-hmm. And although Will has had an extremely chaotic and unsophisticated upbringing and adulthood, he is indeed, I have to say, the most naturally suave and stylish person I have ever met. And
thank you, Dave Ortiz.
And he has taught me the difference between elegance and style. I've always appreciated elegance so much more than style, but from Will I have learned that elegance can be often boring, cold, off-putting, and style, from what I've learned from Will, is always sexy and interesting and charismatic. The last 40 years have been pretty fucked up from what we've heard. But whatever you're doing well, because you look good to me. You're the sexiest 40-year-old I know. So to Will the Thrill, now you can raise your glasses. What I would say is you are a dear friend, a great husband. I look forward to spending the next 40 years with you. And in the words of Shakespeare, you are my first joy, the crown and the comfort of my life. Cheers.
Yeah.
So when he's 80, you're going to divorce the guy then, right?
Well, we'll see.
You said for the next 40 years.
I know. Well, we'll see. We'll see where he's at. I mean, I said he looks good these 40. Let's see what the next 40 do.
Yes!
So the last thing I have to do is Will asked me to do one thing.
2 minutes.
Okay, I'm doing this quick. Will asked me to do one last thing. As you know, he's born in 1963. As you also know, our life's mission is to create a world in our home that is constantly 1963. Part of that is our love of classic television, of modern furniture, and specifically the Dick Van Dyke Show. So Will asked me to do one thing for him. He asked me to serenade him with our mantra, the lyrics from the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Don't
laugh.
It's got reverb.
Okay, it has reverb.
I hope this lasts.
So you think that you've got trouble? Well, trouble's a bubble. So tell old Mr. Trouble to get lost. Very good. Why not? Hold your head up high and stop crying, start smiling, and don't forget to keep your fingers crossed. When you find the key to living is loving and giving, you'll be there when the winning dice are tossed. Well, a smile is just a frown turned upside down, so smile and that frown will get lost, and don't forget to keep your fingers crossed. Dun, 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 dun.
Yeah.
Okay, so you have to introduce
you need to trip over the stairs, Will.
Yeah, exactly. All over the ottoman.
The man we've been making fun of and loving all night and every night.
God almighty.
What's your name again?
Now that...
Frank, you know, sit down.
God, the run out. Hey! There he is.
Yeah. You know, I gotta say, I'm so touched and moved, and I love you guys so much that I can't think of anything rotten to say about you, so... Psych. Anyway, God damn, I got some stupid friends. But anyway, thank you all for coming up. I'm really sorry you could all make it. Once again, we had a midweek event far away, and some people still came. I just don't get it. We're trying to get some time alone here, okay? You get the hint. I'm also really sorry none of my funny friends can make it tonight.